Okay, I hope you can hear me. It sounds as though I'm on the loudspeakers. Good. So, I hope that you appreciate me at least. So, straight on, I want to say that the talk you're going to hear is not, perhaps unusually, all my own work. This is a talk that my wife and I have prepared together, my wife being Mary Shearer. Yes, I'm married, a functional programmer. There are no side effects in our household. Even our son is a Haskell enthusiast. So Mary has been working in the field as long as I have, and this talk is a distillation of both of our experiences. The title here, Why Functional Programming Matters, is the title of a paper I wrote more than 30 years ago, and it must be my most popular paper ever. It's my highest cited paper. So 30 years of trying, and I've not managed to beat it. But it's become one of the papers that many people who take an interest in the field read early on. So I'm fortunate to have written probably a classic of the genre. But this talk is not really, or only to a small extent, about this paper, because the field of functional programming is much older. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to talk about some of the classic papers, some of the classic work in the field, and also some developments that have meant a lot to me and to Mary, and a bit of our own work. So it's a kind of personal history of the field, you might say. So as I say, my paper is 30 years old, but functional programming dates right back to the 1940s. So what was it like in the beginning? Well, in those days, functional programming was very, very minimalist. So take Booleans. Who needs them? What is a Boolean good for, after all? The only thing you need a Boolean for is to make a choice, right? And you can make a choice with a function. So maybe we don't need Booleans. Let's just define true and false to be functions instead. Okay, which functions? Well, they need to make choices. And if you're going to make a choice, you've got to have two things to choose between. So let's give true and false two arguments, x and y. And we'll just say that true is the function that chooses its first argument, and false is the function that chooses its second. Okay, so I'm using Haskell notation here, and I'm going to use Haskell notation for almost all the examples in the talk. But if you use a different programming language, I hope it'll be quite readable even. So these are functions with two arguments, x and y, returning x and y in each case. So I say that these functions correspond to the Booleans. But how do I use Booleans? Well, I use them in an if-then-else construct, right? So can I define if-then-else? Turns out I can. I can define if-then-else as a function. You give it a Boolean, a then branch, and an else branch. And it chooses either the then or the else. How does it do it? It just calls Boolean to make the choice for it. So there we are. There's no need for Booleans in our programming language. We can just use functions instead. Well, that's great. That means our minimalist language doesn't need Booleans. What else might we want in a programming language? Numbers. What about integers? And I mean positive integers in this case. What is an integer good for? Well, what else if not counting loop iterations? Okay, so let me just define the integer 2 to be a function that takes a loop body f and an initial value x and just executes the loop body twice, returning the result. And in the same way, 1 will just execute the loop body once, 0 will execute it 0 times, and so on. So I'm going to claim that these functions that iterate a loop body can represent integers. Well, can I convert them back into a normal Haskell integer? Sure I can. In order to do so, all I need to do is take the function, for example, representing 2, and use it to iterate a loop body that adds 1. So this is the increment function in Haskell, starting from 0. So if I type this into the Haskell, into GHCI, the Haskell redeveloped print loop, then sure enough, I'll get the Haskell integer 2. So I can extract the number back from the function. Well, okay, so now these functions can represent numbers, and I can recover a Haskell number from them. But can I operate on these functions as numbers? Can I, for example, add them together? Well, how might I do that? How might I execute a loop body n plus n times? Well, it's simple, right? First I execute it n times, and then I execute it n more times on the result. So by executing one loop after another, I add together the number of iterations. Great, so that gives me a function that represents n plus n. What about multiplication? Any ideas for doing that? Well, wait a minute. What about nesting loops? Okay, so if I want to execute a loop body n times, I can just use an inner loop that executes f n times, and then an outer loop that executes all of that n times. That's a total of n times n. So that gives me a way of constructing a function that executes the loop body a product of n and n times. Does it work? Well, I could just type it into Haskell. Say, add 1 to 2 times 2, so this should be 5, right? Let's try and iterate increment 5 times on 0. Yes, it works. So cool. So way back in 1940 then, one could be doing one's arithmetic in a functional programming language without booleans and without numbers. Okay, so of course, once you can do arithmetic, what do you want to do? The factorial function. I'm sure you've all been waiting for it. Here's the factorial function, a la 1940. What does it do? Well, it's an if-then-else. If n is 0, we'll just return 1. Otherwise, it's n times the factorial of decrement n. And does it work? Well, we can type it into Haskell again. Let me compute the factorial of 5. If you think about it, that's 120. So will this iterate the increment function 120 times? Yes, sure it does. So, there we are, that's cool. There's a couple of functions I haven't shown you. Is 0, how can I test if one of these functions represents 0? Well, I can just iterate a loop body that returns false n times, starting from true. If n is 0, I'll get true. If n is anything else, I'll get false. And I also need to decrement a number. You can do it. The less said about that, the better. But it works. So, what do we see? We see that just by using functions, we can represent booleans and integers, and actually, any data structure can be represented in this way. I haven't shown you that, but you can do it. And the man who came up with this was Alonzo Church. So these are called Church encodings. Now, why did he want to do this? Well, because Church wanted to show, he wanted to use functional programming as a foundation for mathematics. He wanted to show that you could build everything else out of functions. That would be a sufficient starting point. So that was his interest. But actually, early versions of the Glasgow Haskell compiler really used this stuff. Not to represent integers, that would be stupid, but to represent data structures. And this was first done by a man called Jan Fairbairn, who had his own functional language compiler with some new ideas. It was a very interesting compiler. But he was just hacking it together, and he wanted data structures. So he implemented them using Church encodings. And so then he could program with lists and pairs and all that kind of good stuff. Anyway, after a while, then he realized that the compiler had become mature enough that he really ought to implement data structures properly. So he did. He put in the kind of implementation you might expect. Guess what? The code ran slow. Now that's not the case anymore. It turns out that the code of these Church encodings, it's very direct, but you construct lots of dynamic functions which you're calling all the time. So you're often calling unknown functions, and that really screws with branch prediction. So nowadays, if you use these encodings, the code will run slower than a more conventional implementation. But way back in the early 90s, branch prediction wasn't so important, and this was actually the fastest way to implement data structures there for a while. Okay, so everything I've shown you here is runnable Haskell code. You might go away and try it at home. If you do, let me warn you that if you just type in what I've shown you, you'll get a typo. The compiler says, there's an occurs check, we can't construct the infinite type, blah, blah, blah. Okay, infinite type. That sounds bad, doesn't it? But don't worry. The type checker, Haskell type checker, gives you additional helpful information. It tells you which type of was expected. And which type it got. This is the first time I've been able to use the 3-point font on the slide. Now I realise that, even here this might be rather overwhelming, but don't worry, there's more. You also get a bunch of emojis. So you can't just use these church encodings so directly in Haskell, because the type checker doesn't understand what's going on. You have to give it a little bit of help. What you have to do is tell it the type of that factorial function. And I'm showing you the type here. The black stuff is all stuff the type checker will be able to figure out for itself, but you have to tell it the stuff in red. So one line of code makes that work. Okay, so Church could have lots of fun writing functional programs way back in the 40s. But he couldn't actually run them. That's a shame, isn't it? He couldn't run functional programs till about 1960, when John McCarthy came up with Lisp. Here's a factorial function in Lisp. Label means it's recursive, lambda means it's a function. Otherwise, apart from all the brackets, it looks much less factorial than any other language. So that was a huge step forward. It meant that we could run functional programs, and we could even run quite advanced functional programs with higher-order functions, for example. So Lisp had what was called MapLisp then, we call Map today, which you could use to take the factorial function and apply it to all the elements of a list, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and you'd get the list of results. So you could do a lot of cool functional programming already back in 1960. And indeed, in the early 60s, then, especially among more theoretical computer scientists, there was a lot of interest in functional programming. And there's a whole theory of programming languages that dates, whose origins date from that time, based on functional programming. But I want to skip rather quickly over that and come to another classic paper of the genre. The next 700 programming languages by Peter Landau. So I'm just going to read the abstract of this paper to you. Today, 1,700 special programming languages are used to communicate in over 700 application areas. 1,700 programming languages in 1965. Well, Peter Landin thought that was 1,699 too many. He thought that it would be better to have one programming language, his programming language, and 700 different libraries, one for each application area, which makes a lot of sense. So he designed a language of his own called ISWIM, which stands for If You See What I Mean. And it's been a huge influence on at least functional programming languages since then. So this is a truly landmark. This is the factorial function in ISWIM, by the way. I don't want to focus so much on the ISWIM language itself as on something else that Peter Landin put great emphasis on in that paper. And that was what he called laws. What is a law? Well, it's an equivalence between two programs which should have exactly the same effect, so that you should always be able to replace one by the other. This is an example of a law about Lisp programs, which says that if you take a list, reverse it, and then apply F to each element, you get the same result as if you first apply F to each element and then reverse the list. So you can imagine that you would expect to be able to replace the left-hand side by the right-hand side anywhere in your code. And by so doing, you might be able to optimize your program, for example. I mean, maybe reverse L is shared and you only need to compute it once, or whatever. Unfortunately, this law isn't actually true in Lisp. And it's not true because in Lisp, functions can have side effects. So the left-hand side calls F in one order, and the right-hand side makes the calls in the reverse order. So you might get different results. And Landin disapproved of that. Landin thought, laws are there to be followed, and they should hold without exception. And he actually discusses this in his paper. He says, well, you might think that there's no point in having two different ways to do the same thing. Wouldn't it be better if these two programs did something slightly different, because then you could choose between them? So, you know, if they do different things, then you have two possibilities instead of one. Isn't that better? Landon thunders. No! Expressive power should be by design, rather than by accident. It's just Landon. So he places huge emphasis on law and equivalences between programs that we've always told that we can use to reason about programs and to transform programs. And that's something that has been important in functional programming ever since. So I want to skip forward a little bit now again, this time to another classic paper by John Backus. John Backus won the Turing Award in 1977. Who knows what John Backus did? Okay, well, I get to tell you about it. So, you've heard of John Backus, even if you think you haven't. You've heard of BNF, Backus normal form. So John Backus came up with that, the way that we describe the grammar of programming languages. But more than that, he was the man who led the development of the first Fortran compiler. Now, Fortran, which compiler started working in the late 50s, it was the first really successful high-level language. Why? Because in those days, then all people cared about was performance. So way back when Fortran was under development, there were still people who thought that you couldn't use assembly language, because if you use assembly language, you could be too far from the underlying machine. You couldn't, for example, reuse a bit pattern from an instruction as data if it happened to be the right value. And if you can't do that, how can you write efficient code? So the idea of using a high-level language like Fortran is beyond the pale. But the Fortran compiler that John Backus and his team developed could consistently generate code that was better than a human programmer could write. And that was what made Fortran such a huge success. Suddenly all these people who didn't think you could afford to use assembly language could use Fortran instead of writing machine code and get better performance. So that's what Backus got his Turing Award for. And by the time he got it, Fortran was already getting kind of old, and it was the programming language that all programming language people love to hate. You know, there are so many mistakes in the design, but one shouldn't let that, you know, reduce one's understanding of the enormous achievement it was. So he could have given his Turing Award lecture. When you win the Turing Award, you get to give a lecture, you get to write a paper. He could, of course, have talked about the Fortran compiler, the work they did to make it, you know, all the techniques they used to make it a success. I'm sure people expected that. But he didn't, because by then, John Backus was kind of fed up with Fortran too. So he gave his Turing Award lecture about his new love, functional programming. And that, I cannot overestimate the importance that that had. The man who gave us Fortran used his Turing lecture to say, it was all a mistake. We should do functional programming instead. It's as though Bjarne Stausdorff were to give a, you know, if he ever wins the Turing Award, he were to give a Turing Award lecture saying object orientation was all wrong. I should have been using Haskell all along. So it's hugely important. And the paper that he wrote is a real classic of the genre. I'm just going to quote a little bit from the introduction to the paper. Listen to this. Conventional programming languages are growing ever more enormous, but not stronger. He's thinking here in particular of languages like Ada, which was being pushed very heavily at the time. Inherent defects at the most basic level cause them to be both fat and weak. It's stirring stuff, isn't it? Their primitive word-at-a-time style of programming, inherited from their common ancestor, the von Neumann computer. What's he talking about here? Well, he explains that the computer consists of a processor and some memory and the bus in between, which he called the von Neumann bottleneck. That's why there's a picture of the bottleneck here. And the way that programs worked is they would transfer one word at a time between the processor and the memory, and the programs in the programming languages at the time were similar. And he thought that was terrible. Their inability to use powerful combining forms to build new programs from existing ones. What does he mean by this? I'm going to illustrate some of his combining forms with diagrams, and these are going to recur later in the talk, so let me explain what they mean. I'm going to draw functions as boxes, and the data is going to flow from the right to the left, which just works more nicely for these diagrams. So Backus proposed combining forms to build new functions from old ones. For example, apply to all, that he wrote as alpha, and that nowadays we would call map. So that takes a function that operates on data and turns it into a function that operates on a list of data and applies f to each element. Okay, so this is one combining form for building new functions from old that Backus proposed for. Another one he called construction. So here, if you have a collection of functions, the f's, then you might construct a function that applies all of them to the same data. So when the data comes in, it's split, all the functions are applied, and you get a list of results. And so that was part of Backus's proposed programming language. Their lack of useful mathematical properties for reasoning about programs. But what's he talking about here? Well, let's look at this diagram. So this diagram, which I've expressed in Backus's notation at the top there, represents, first of all, applying a function, this is g, and then taking its output and applying each of a collection of other functions to it. But if you think about it, that should behave the same way as this program, in which we replicate the input data first, and then we apply both g and one of the f's in each case. And that would be written as this thing down at the bottom. This dot here is function composition. So what do we see here? Well, we see one of Backus's laws that says that the program at the top is equal to the program at the bottom, always. Backus was also very concerned with laws equating programs. And let's just see an example of putting all this together. Here is a program for computing the inner product or scalar product of two vectors. This is written in Algol 60, which Backus also helped design. And you can see that it's very much word at a time programming. It takes one element from each vector at a time and then multiplies them together and then sums everything up with a series of additions in a loop. And this is exactly what Backus thought we should not do. Instead, he thought we should write this. Okay, what's this? It's a functional program for inner product, which first of all takes a pair of vectors, transposes them to get a vector of pairs, then applies multiplication to all those pairs, so we get a vector of products, and then adds them all up using slash plus. And that slash is what we would call fold R nowadays. So this is exactly like a Haskell program for the same problem might appear. And rather than working a word at a time, it works with whole values, whole vectors at a time. And the program is constructed with combining forms, alpha, function composition, fold R, that are just put together nicely. So I think Backus did have a little bit of ABL envy in his choice of notation, but the ideas that he was pushing, they're very much the ones that we use in functional languages today. So this was a truly landmark paper, and it inspired a whole generation of researchers to work on functional programming, myself included. So if there's one thing you remember from this talk, it's this. If you have not read this paper, straight after the talk, Google John Backus Turing Award, and the first or second hit will be his Turing Award paper. Read it. At least the first half. The second half of the paper contains some ideas that haven't had quite the same staying power, but the first half of that paper is a wonderful manifesto for functional programming. And everybody interested in the field should read it. Okay, so there we are. That's a trip through some classic papers. Now, I want to move forward a little bit to a paper that has meant a lot to Mary and I personally. It's on a subject called functional geometry by Peter Henderson. Remember that name? There he is. Peter was Mary's doctoral supervisor. And he had two great loves in life, functional programming and the artwork of M.C. Escher. Here's an example of that. This one is called Square Limit. And Peter just loved these etchings, woodcuts. And in particular, He was fascinated by the idea of trying to construct the recursive structure, this kind of picture, using functional programming. So this paper is how he did that. Now, Peter, in those days, if you wanted to do graphics, you had to send drawing commands to a graph plotter, which would pick up pens and draw on paper. It's hard to imagine, but that's how graphics worked in those days. So we had a graph plotter. But Peter didn't want to send drawing commands one at a time. That would be so word at a time, wouldn't it? No. Peter wanted to work with whole values. And what should the whole values be in this context? Well, a picture. For example, this one. This is a fish. So if you can name an entire picture as a value, then you can operate on pictures. So for example, you can define combining forms for putting them together. Here, I've put together, I've overlaid the fish with a double rotation of a fish. Rotation here is 90 degrees, so double rotation is 180 degrees. But you can see we've got fish kind of eating each other's tails. And you can actually take that fish, you can also rotate it just 45 degrees. So fish 2 is a 45 degree rotation. And then overlay, you get a smaller fish, so you can overlay the larger fish and two smaller ones. And you get a little picture like this, in which you can see that the fish are getting smaller in one direction. And if we look back at the original print, you can see that we need to construct fish getting smaller and smaller. So that was good. So what else can you do? Well, here is the 45 degree fish overlaid with itself four times, with three different rotations of itself, rather. And look, we get four fish swimming around in a circle. This looks like the center of the picture. So Peter in his paper goes on to develop more operations on pictures, for example, quartet, that lets you put four pictures into a square, and then shows how to construct bits of the picture. So, for example, let's consider the sides of the pictures. On the side of the picture, the fish gets smaller and smaller. But I already showed you a little picture with a big fish and two small ones. And it turns out that if we take that, if we rotate it and put it beside itself, and make a quartet, and on the top there, I've just put in two empty pictures, then we get a row of fish getting smaller. But, of course, they get smaller in one step, but we need more steps of getting smaller. But I've got that space up at the top. So what if I call this picture side one, and then I put two copies of it instead of the nils? Then we get the side of the picture in which the fish get smaller in four steps. And if I continue in this manner, you can imagine that I can make a kind of infinite regress of smaller and smaller fish to make up the side of the picture. Likewise, I can make corners. If I start off with these four square fish swimming in a circle, and then put three blank pictures around them, then I can take that corner and put a smaller corner in the top left, and two sides in the top right and bottom left boxes. And I get a corner that has fish getting a bit smaller. And by continuing this process, I can get an infinite regress of smaller and smaller fish. So Peter shows how to construct both of these things, and then puts everything together to make square limit by combining nine pictures in the square, four copies of the side, four copies of the corner, and that picture in the middle with four fish swimming in a circle. And this is what you get. Isn't that cool? Just a little bit of functional programming, and you get something that looks very like Escher's print, doesn't it? Cool. Well, Mary actually wrote the implementation of functional geometry. We would watch these things coming out on the graph plotter. It would take hours, because those tiny little fish would take forever to draw, but the results were brilliant. So that's cool. But wait, there's more. Peter had to represent pictures somehow. Okay, we want to work with pictures as whole values, but how can we represent a picture? Let's see, how can we represent anything? Let's think back to church. Yes, let's represent a picture as a function. How can we do that? Peter had a very clever way. He said, let a picture be a function that given three vectors, A, B, and C, that define the position of a blue rectangle in the plane, returns the list of plotter commands to draw the picture in that blue rectangle. Okay, so that lets us define a picture as a function, but it also makes it really easy to define the combining forms. So how would you draw P and Q overlaid within the same rectangle? Well, easy. You just construct drawing commands for P and drawing commands for Q, and you combine them. How would you put a picture P beside a picture Q in a particular rectangle? Like this. Well, it's easy. You just split the rectangle by splitting that bottom vector into P over 2, and then you draw P in the left rectangle, so I've given it P over 2 as its second argument, and you draw Q in the right one, so I have to add P over 2 to its origin. You can even rotate pictures in the same way. This isn't quite so obvious, but suppose I want to rotate P. Well, what I have to do is put the bottom left corner of P over here at A plus B instead. And then by negating B and swapping B and C, I can get P to draw itself on the side like that. So that's how you define a rotation. And the nice things about these definitions are, A, they're extremely simple, and B, they're very easy to reason about. So Peter was able to prove laws like this one. I've not shown you above, but you can imagine what it does. So this says if you put P above Q and rotate it, that is the same as rotating P, rotating Q, and putting one beside the other. Very obvious when you look at hands, very easy to prove as well. And Peter observed that proving these laws was very helpful in design. He said, it seems there's a positive correlation between the simplicity of the rules, the laws, and the quality of the algebra as a description tool. So what we see here are those basic ideas coming back again. Working with whole values, not word at a time. Putting programs together with combining forms. Using the laws as a litmus test for a design to see is it good or not. And just like church, using functions as representations. While we're talking about geometry, I want to quickly tell you about another paper that isn't so well known, with a really weird title, but it's one of my favorites. But it's called Haskell versus Ada versus C++ versus Orc versus blah, blah, blah. An experiment in software prototyping productivity. So way back in the early 90s, then you couldn't get research money for using functional programming for real code, notably Vanguard. But you could get research money for using functional programming for prototyping. Prototyping was hot in those days. It's kind of like microservices today. And Paul Hudak, who was a leader in functional programming, one of the designers of Haskell, got money from a big DARPA grant in software prototyping. And so did many other people. So after a while, DARPA wanted to see how their various research groups were doing. So they thought, let's give them all the same problem to solve and see how well they do. So the reason the paper is called Haskell versus Ada versus etc. is that those were the languages that other groups were proposing to use for software prototyping. Orc for software prototyping. Well, okay, it's hard to fathom today, maybe, but you know, it's up to DARPA how they spend their money. So DARPA gave this problem, and Mark Jones, another great functional programming researcher, was the guy who got the job of implementing the prototype. So what was the problem? Well, DARPA being DARPA, it was actually a problem of 2D geometry. So the prototype was supposed to take the locations and paths of your aircraft and carriers and so on, and then classify the plane into regions with strange names like weapon doctrine and slave doctrine and engageability zone. And then it was supposed to output something like this. You know, at time 40, the commercial aircraft will be in the engageability zone of the tight zone, and the hostile craft will be in the carrier-slave doctrine. Okay, who knows what those things mean? But they got a description of how to compute these regions. So Mark had the problem of building this prototype as quickly as he could. He had to represent regions in the plane. How might you represent a region? Wait a minute, what about a function? So Mark chose to represent a region by a function from points to booleans that would return true for a point that was in the region. And that made it really easy to define, for example, a circle of a given radius. You just take the point you're given and you compare distance to the origin. Is it less than or greater than the radius? The outside of a region, you just negate the boolean. Intersection, you just take the and of two booleans. It's extremely simple. As you can imagine, he didn't have to write very much code. Here's the code for constructing that ring shape. This, I think, is the engageability zone. And it's just the outside of one circle intersected with the inside of another. So Mark wrote this prototype, and when the results came into DARPA, this is what they looked like. I know the font is kind of small. I'll read out the important bits. Up the top there is Mark's Haskell solution for the prototype. 85 lines of code. And that compares very well with, for example, Ada 9x, 800 lines, or C++, 1105. But what I think is a shame is that in Haskell, then the type checker can infer a lot of types for you. In particular, for most functions, it can infer the type signature. But Mark is a guy who likes to write type signatures. So he'd done that, and if he hadn't, he wrote 29 lines that the type checker could have put in for him. So that could have been a 56-line solution. Anyway, so these figures came into the evaluators. And they just didn't believe it. They thought, there's something funny here about this Mark Jones guy. So without telling Paul or Mark, they found a graduate student somewhere else. And they gave him a week to learn Haskell. And then they got him to solve the problem. And that's why Haskell is in this list twice. The graduate student wrote a 156-line solution. That's almost twice as big as Mark's. But it's still the second smallest in the list. So that's not bad with 8 days of experience, eh? So you look at these things and you think, this was a tremendous success for the program. You know, surely DARPA must have realized that this was an idea to back. So what was the reaction? It's too cute for its own good. Higher order functions are just a trick, probably not useful in other contexts. So next time you use a higher order function, you can remember that. Okay, so this is a lovely experiment, and I will only show you one table from the paper. There's a lot more goodness in there. So after the talk, I recommend looking that up. But let me go back in time a little bit now. Back to an idea that was a great inspiration for me personally, and that's the idea of lazy evaluation. There were two papers in 1976 that both proposed the same idea. A lazy evaluation by Henderson and Morris. Look, see that Henderson guy? Same one. And in the US, then Friedman and Wise, of cons should not evaluate its arguments. And these are both classic papers also. In fact, there were several other people around the same time who also discovered lazy evaluation. So the idea of lazy evaluation is that when you construct part of a data structure or when you pass an argument to a function, you shouldn't compute it straight away. You should just remember how to compute it. And then if the value is ever needed by the code you pass it to, then you should pay the cost of doing the computation. So if you're not familiar with lazy evaluation, I think the best way to explain it is to say that it's like trying to get a teenager out of the house. So if you're a parent, you may have experienced this. Say, put on your coat. I will. Put on your shoes. I will. Clean your teeth. I will. We're going now. Oh, wait a minute. Maybe some of you have experienced that. So all the work gets done when you actually need them. So why was this so inspiring to me? Well, I love this idea of programming with a whole value instead of word at the time. And with lazy evaluation, the whole value can be infinite. It could be the list of all natural numbers, for example, or the list of all the iterations of a function. Right? We talked about loops where you iterate a function a certain number of times. Now we just make a list of them all. Now this doesn't mean, of course, that we're going to compute all the iterations of a function. We couldn't. What it means is that it's the consumer of this data structure that decides how many to compute. And I realized this meant that I could separate the code that decides how much to compute from the code that specifies how to compute it. And I had, a few years earlier, had to study numerical analysis, which I was very bad at. But I realized that many numerical methods work by constructing a potentially infinite sequence of approximations and then selecting the limit when the sequence converges. And I've always had to write that convergence test over and over again in every numerical problem I implemented. Now I could write one consumer function that would just do that convergence test, give any sequence of approximations. And I could, for example, compute square roots. Here's the Newton-Raphson square root method. You start from some approximation for the square root. I'm starting from 1.0. I'm constructing the list of all iterations of this next function that computes the next approximation from the previous. And I'm taking the limit. Here is a program for computing derivatives. You can compute a numerical derivative by taking a function f. You evaluate it at the point x you're interested in, plus a little bit. Subtract the value of the point x and divide by the little bit. So that measures the slope of a straight line approximation to the curve between x and x plus h. And as you make h smaller and smaller, then that converges to the value of the derivative. So once again, I could use the same convergence check, reuse the same code, and just write different code for the approximation sequences. I thought that was nice. But there's more. I remembered a trick that I learned in my numerical analysis course. Let's see, I already explained that differentiation is done by taking the point you're interested in and one a little bit away and computing the slope of the straight line. Integration can be computed by splitting the interval you want to integrate over into little rectangles of width h. And in both cases, as h gets smaller, the result gets more exact. So we've got two processes that each depend on this parameter h. Well, it turns out when you do a numerical computation this way, you can write the result in this form. It's the right answer a plus some error term, which depends on the power of h. Okay, so here's the trick. Suppose we compute two approximations, one for some value of h, and the next for half that value. Now, we've got two approximations. We know both values. They're both in this form. We have two unknowns, A and B. Remember high school mathematics? With two equations like this and two unknowns, you can solve them. So you can figure out, in particular, A, the right answer from just two approximations. So these numerical methods compute a whole sequence of approximations. All you have to do is take the first two, and you can compute the right answer directly. Isn't that brilliant? Well, in fact, you can take the next two as well, and you can compute a whole sequence of right answers. And unfortunately, they're not all the same. Well, there is no magic in the world, really. And the reason they're not all the same is that this form is itself an approximation. So the error term there is not exactly a power of h. There are other powers of h as well, larger powers. But what we do here is we take the blue sequence that converges at one rate, and we construct a green sequence that converges much faster. It's a better numerical method, a higher order numerical method. And we can write a simple function that does that. Improve n, remove the nth order error term, which will converge much faster than the original. So here's a really fast derivative function. First of all, compute the approximations by computing the slope but halving h at each step, as before. And then let's improve it twice, why not? And take the limit. And all of this code is just reusing the same functions. Everything's programmed separately. Everything is easy to understand, even for me, who is not good at numerical analysis. And it's all thanks to whole value programming, that we can treat the whole sequence of approximations as one value. By the way, this works nicely for derivatives. It works even better for integration, where every approximation costs twice as much to compute as the one before. So something that converges really fast gives you a very good integration method. So that was great fun. And these are some of the early examples in my paper, Why Function Programming Matters. So if you read the paper, then you'll find all this explained in much more detail. So what I've shown you is the idea of separating a producer of values from a consumer, where the consumer determines how much gets computed. making demands for values and getting them back. I've shown you how we can use that with a convergence test and a numerical algorithm, but you can use it in many other contexts too. For example, a search strategy and the search space. Now, in my old paper, that I showed how to program the alpha-beta search heuristic as such a separate strategy, I built a search space for the game of noughts and crosses. It could be for any game, but I had a very small computer, so I did noughts and crosses. And the alpha-beta heuristic is a complicated search algorithm, which I had previously only ever seen woven together with the code for exploring the search space. But now I could separate it out in a reusable part. I really love that. I'm not going to show you any detail of that. I do want to just mention another paper that I wrote a few years later on pretty printing. Pretty printing is the problem of taking, for example, a data structure and displaying it as ASCII text in a readable form, or taking source code and displaying it in a standardized layout. And if you've ever written a pretty printer, you will know how hard it is to get those suckers right. But I designed a library for it, using the same idea, where using my library, I could construct a document with many alternative layouts, a search space, and a separate search criterion that would just pick the best one. So how would these documents be put together? With combinators, of course, for doing things like composing documents horizontally or vertically, or indenting a document, or making a choice between horizontal and vertical layouts. Here's a pretty printer for Haskell trees, built using this library. So the tree type just has leaves and branches, and the pretty printer says for a leaf, make a fixed layout, that's what that text combinator does. For a branch, make a choice between horizontal and vertical layouts. And in the vertical case, the subtrees will be indented to spaces. So you can see that I can write the pretty printer, I can express what the choices are that I want to make, but I don't have to make those choices. That's all done by the library. And then the result is that you get output like this, where you can see small trees have been displayed on one line, larger ones have been split with this two spaces of layout that the library specifies. So this is another of my very popular papers. It also contains laws. These combinators satisfy laws. So if you put A above B beside C, that looks like this. But we can split that picture up this way also. And that's A above B beside C. So we've got a law that these combinators always satisfy. And as I was designing the library, I used those to tell me when the design was right. You might not have realized that beside would behave like this on the right. But it does, because I wanted to make this law hold. Here's a law that doesn't hold, though. If you put A beside B above C, you don't get the same result as if you put A beside B above C. Because the indentation of C depends on what you put it below. In this case, it's below B. In this case, it's below A. And so there's a law that doesn't hold. And that's what makes these particular combinators interesting, that there's one law that doesn't hold. How does the implementation work? It uses the laws to guarantee that the result I produce is the one that you intended. Just simplifies the layout until we get the one that we want. So this paper is another nice example of using these same basic principles. I can't resist a shameless plug here. You might ask, if I want to use laws to assess my design, how do I know which laws my function satisfy? I had to prove them way back then. Now, we have a tool that, given your program, will just tell you which laws it satisfies. And my colleagues have recently come up with an improvement that can discover all of the laws about my pretty printing library, for example. So I could have done it much more easily today. Now, I know this was a good idea because so many smart people have improved on it. So this paper has spawned an entire little literature on combinators for pretty printing. And almost no matter which functional language you're using today, if you look in the libraries, you'll find a pretty printing library that perhaps through a series of steps could be traced back to this paper I'm talking about. Okay, so what am I best known for nowadays? Well, probably QuickCheck. What's QuickCheck do? If you've not seen it before, this is the airline version I'm going to show you. We write a property of our code. For example, this property says, for any list X's, if you reverse it twice, you get the list you started off with. And we can just gives this property to QuickCheck, and it runs 100 random tests by default and says, yes, this property is true. If you write a property that's not true, like this one, it says, if you reverse a list, you get back the same list, then QuickCheck says, no, that's not true. Here's a counterexample. This is a random counterexample. As you can see, it's long, it's hard to understand what the problem is. But then QuickCheck shrinks it to a minimal counterexample. In this case, 0, 1. This is the shortest, this is a minimal list that's not its own reversal. Why is it minimal? Well, if we remove either element, we'd have another element list. That is its own reversal. Why isn't it 0, 0? Well, because 0, 0 is its own reversal. So 0, 1 is minimal both in length and in the elements. So QuickCheck is a wonderful tool for testing programs, but what does it do? QuickCheck has a search strategy that is the same for all properties, and the properties constructs a space of all possible tests. It's a search space. But in this case, QuickCheck first does a random search, and then a systematic one for a minimal example. So it's the same idea. I only have one idea, it seems. But luckily it's a good one. Okay, so now I want to quickly move to something else that was very important around, in the 70s and 80s. This book, Mead and Conway, Introduction to VLSI Systems. Has anybody read it? No, but you can still get it. It's $6 on Amazon at the moment. So this book revolutionized VLSI design. Before Mead and Conway, VLSI design meant drawing rectangles on silicon. Afterwards, it meant thinking about the high-level structure of hardware. So it really was a revolution. And it inspired many, many researchers, including Mary, who was trained as an electrical engineer, and wanted to construct hardware using functional programming. So Mary took Mead and Conway's ideas, designed a hardware language based on Bax's FP. I showed you Bax's FP using diagrams, which looked a little bit like block diagrams of hardware. There's a reason for that. But for hardware, you have to add unit delay elements as well, which I'm going to draw with these blue circles. And Mary realized that Bax's combining forms could be used for hardware too. And that Bax's laws could be used for reasoning about alternative hardware designs. But there were additional laws about these unit delays. Here's one. This is a retiming law. So here the orange box is a circuit whose inputs come from above and the right. And on the left you can see that the outputs are delayed once clock cycle. But that should of course behave the same as this circuit, where the inputs are delayed instead. So that's the basic retiming law. And now if we think of a circuit like this, where we have a long chain of orange computational elements, this is actually a very bad circuit, because there's a long combinational path that runs all the way through these orange boxes. So in one clock cycle, you have to wait for data to ripple all the way from the right to the left. You can't clock it very fast. But suppose we were just to delay all the inputs by 4 steps. Okay, well that wouldn't really help in itself. But now we can apply retiming to this box of these two delays here. Like that. And now to the next box. And the next one. And the next one. And when we finish that, we've moved one delay all the way to the output. So now let's leave this leftmost column alone and do the same thing again. And again. And again. And when we finish this, we end up with a circuit in which there's a delay element between each of these boxes. This circuit is much better, because at one clock cycle, data only has to get from here to here. So you can probably clock this circuit twice as fast. We've introduced pipelining. Of course, it's the standard technique in hardware design. But it's difficult to get right, because you also have to figure out that you need to add this triangle of delay elements in order to get the same behavior. And figuring out where to put those triangles is actually quite hard. That's what Mary's thesis work made easy. And it actually had users. Plessy picked this up, and they were designing a video motion estimator, which is part of video compression, chip for that. And they wrote in their paper, using UFP, the array processing element was described in just one line of code, and the complete array required 4 lines of UFP description. UFP enabled the effects of adding or moving data latches within the array to be assessed quickly. So that was a great success. So what happened next? What happened next was that Plessy was bought by General Electric and Siemens, and they weren't interested in this at all. They probably thought it was too cute for its own good. And so that got shut down. But Mary continued working in the area, and her graduate student, Satnam Singh, took UFP and combined it with functional geometry. Why would you do that? Well, UFP is very good at giving the semantics of hardware. Functional geometry gives placement. And it's very useful to be able to describe those two at the same time. So Satnam went to work at Xilinx and used them to generate FPGA layouts for Xilinx chips, just to see the effect of providing this functional geometry. This is four adder trees, just put through the Xilinx tools with no placement information. And here's what we would get from Lava. You can see it's much more regular. And the result is that this version will perform better and is much more likely to fit on the particular chip you have. So Satnam, when he was working for Xilinx, he'd get problems. Customers would come and say, we can't fit our solution onto your FPGA. And Satnam would write some Haskell code using Lava to generate FPGA layouts for them, give them Windows binaries. They never knew they were running Haskell, but they were. That was a great success. Okay, so I'm out of time. And so I'll skip a little story at the end. I know, but we've come a long way in this talk, from church encodings of numbers down to functional programs running on FPGAs. And we've seen the same ideas come back again and again. Programming with whole values, putting programs together with combining forms, focusing on simple laws that those forms should obey, and using functions as representations. Those ideas have paid off again and again and again. I think backers will be proud of us. Thank you. Group view is going to be interesting. It's not super straightforward. There are a variety of operations on this. In the group, you have one operation, plus you have an inverse operation, which there's no inverse for picture in this group. So the operations on pictures do not form a group. But of course, there are a couple of different monoids in there, and there are other algebraic structures. So in general, looking at the algebraic structure of pictures is, yeah, that's really important. And groups are another example of a very interesting You are, I think, are thinking in particular looking at the symmetries of the pictures. And, well...
Well, it's an issue that I can actually a lot of them are just actually group operators.
Yeah.
I don't know about the square ones, but for example...
I think one would need to sit down and think quite hard to maybe come up with a relation. It's not direct.
All right, thank you.